I'm going to give some advice to new faculty with regard to teaching. And I'm going to assume that we're talking about a place like Cornell, a major research institution. Now, I will say that in my experience, Cornell is special in that Cornell actually does care about undergraduate teaching. I believe that. And that actually makes what I'm about to say even more important, because if you were at a place that didn't care about undergraduate teaching, it would not be ambiguous what you should do. It would be clear. You should just do your research, minimize your investment in your teaching, because it's not going to matter anyway. Okay. The problem at Cornell is it does matter. Okay. We don't hire people that we know will be bad teachers. You know, we hire some people that turn out once in a while to be bad teachers. We hire people that turn out sometimes to be mediocre teachers, but I don't think anybody here, not in my department anyway, intentionally hires somebody that will obviously be poor at teaching undergrad. So it's expected of you. And I think the hardest thing about being an academic, especially at a big research university, and even more so at one like Cornell, where it is genuinely expected you will also do a reasonably good job teaching, is to get your priorities straight, to learn how to say no, and to not overbook yourself. So I think when you're an assistant professor, it's so tempting to believe that you have to do everything, that you can't turn anybody down. And the truth is, you don't have to do everything, and you can turn some people down. You need to get clear within sort of the culture of your department, your college, what is expected of you in terms of getting tenure? What are the standards for each of these expectations? I would hope you'd have a mentor, and if you don't have one, you should go find one. Somebody in your department you can look up to who's been successful at the various things that are being expected and get their advice. And then I have one little practical tip. Get yourself a dry board, put it on the wall of your office, and it needs to be, for me, the most likely place would be on the wall next to your entrance door. But the point is, you need to be able to see this dry board from where you sit, from where you talk on the phone, and from where you face anybody that comes in your office to talk to you. And on this dry board, you list the names of your grad students, the names of the courses you teach, the names of the committees you're on, and the names of any other major time sink responsibilities you have. And it needs to be in big enough letters that you can read it from where you're sitting, from where you're talking on the phone. And that's so when the dean of your college calls and says, we've just got to have a woman on this committee. And this is a problem for women, I think, more than men, because, you know, if you're a woman faculty member and you're one of the relatively fewer women faculty member, you're going to get asked more, because we need women representing on things. So in any case, the idea is you have this where you can see it. The dean calls and says, I really need you to do this. And you look up there and you're already on four committees like this at the campus-wide level. And then you tell the dean, I'm really sorry, but I'm already on so-and-so's task force for international students. I'm doing this. I'm serving on the IACUC. And I'm teaching three classes, and I'm pre-tenure. I could not do a good job if I did this. And it's amazing how often that will work, by and large. People don't actually get mad at you if you explain to them that you're already doing your share. And I think it's so tempting to think that you don't have any recourse but to say yes over and over again. So that would be my advice, is get very clear on your priorities. Use little tricks like my dry board idea, if you need them, to keep those priorities straight in front of you until you really get it into your rhythm and can do it without so much attention to it.